Welcome to Music in the News and the Bible, evaluating popular music, the artists, and their performances with Judgment Day honesty. For more information about Music in the News and the Bible, visit DoubleEdgeMusic.com. Here is gospel recording artist Troy Isaacs.
As usual, my goal is to help you examine your music, the artists, and their performance with Judgment Day honesty. If there's an artist you would like me to do a story on, please email me at info@DoubleEdgeMusic.com. Today we're going to begin a series on R. Kelly. And if you've spent any time online or social media or on television, you'll know that last week Lifetime released a series called Surviving R. Kelly that lasted for 6 hours. And also last night, Dateline had an episode called The Accused. And they talked about R. Kelly and the various women he's been involved with. And so we're going to look at that in this episode today. And I'm beginning a series. And number one, we're going to talk about his success. We're going to look at his rise to fame, the things that he accomplished. Next, we will look at his secrets, the things that have been hidden for decades that are now just starting to come out. Next, we will look at his sadism. We will look at the activity, the lifestyle and practice he's had. And should we support these type of artists? Next, we will look at his servants. And if you've done any reading or if you've watched the docuseries, you'll know that R. Kelly didn't know how to read. And in fact, he was taught how to read from Andrea Kelly, who eventually became his wife, one of his wives. And so he had to have servants, people to help him do a lot of things, a lot of the things he did. Then he will look at the scandal, obviously the infamous scandal with the 14-year-old girl. And we will talk about what does God have to say about those things. Then we will look at the sentence. And this guy was acquitted of 23 counts of child pornography. But what will God's word, what will God have to say on the matter? What sentence would God hand down? And then we will look at his Satanism, because obviously the media didn't cover R. Kelly's occultic activity. Now, there's some who said he has created this sex cult with these young women. So we will look at that. And then we will look at the survivors or salvation. And lastly, we will look at what I call a surprise. But now I'm reading from Carolyn, and she wrote an article in Variety. It's been 25 years since R. Kelly first had to answer for his sexual abuse allegations. 2.5 decades of new reports, new witnesses, new testimonies, new windows into an age-old story of powerful men seizing the chance to play God while trampling countless women / girls into the dirt. And yet, as a devastating new docuseries lays out in damning detail, Kelly has nonetheless found a way to evade the charges and any real consequences almost every time. In 6-hour-long chapters, Lifetime Surviving R. Kelly is perhaps the most comprehensive dive into the terrible, tangled history of allegations against the singer yet. The first 2 episodes dig into his childhood, in which he both was recognized as a musical prodigy and was sexually molested as a child. It also talks about his unstoppable rise to stardom and his relationship to Aaliyah, whom he met when she was just 12 years old. The 3rd and 4th episodes detail the circumstances of the so-called P-tape, which allegedly showed Kelly having sex with and urinating on a 14-year-old minor, and the subsequent child pornography case that ended in a surprise acquittal. The final 2 episodes highlight the reports from the last several years that Kelly has isolated and groomed women and girls into a sex cult for his own pleasure. So as I said, we're going to dive into this. And in this episode, we want to cover 3 things. Again, we will look at his success, his secrets, and his sadism. And we want to see what the Bible has to say on these issues. My friend, if you know anyone that's been abused in any way, you want to make sure they tune in to these 3 shows. All right, now we're going to take a break. And we'll be back.
Life can be difficult at times, and we may go through ups and downs or experience financial hardship.
Maybe you had a loan modification, a short sale, or even filed for bankruptcy.
Hey everyone, this is Mike.
And this is Brian of Fellowship Home Loans.
You could be in a modified mortgage and not even realize that the rate is adjustable. Maybe it contains a balloon payment, or maybe you're not even paying any principal.
A modification is a short-term fix.
Call us today to get your mortgage evaluated and receive the truth about what you can qualify for. 800-804-SAVE. That's 800-804-7283. Or online at fellowshiphomeloans.com. All listeners receive 2-month break in mortgage payments and $1,000 back at closing. Mortgage lending guided by Christian principles.
Come and get your loan, Fellowship Home Loans.
Intercontinental Capital Group, DBA, Fellowship Home Loans, Equal Housing Opportunity Lender, NMLS number 60134.
We're hearing from a young woman who says she met R. Kelly when she was just a teenager working as an intern. Speaking out in a Dateline interview that'll air tonight, she accuses Kelly of abusive behavior. And we're also hearing from the embattled singer's attorney.
I was in love with him. I just didn't know what to do. Like, I didn't know if this was normal. I didn't know if this is how adults acted. Like, I just didn't know. I didn't know.
Tracy Sampson says she was introduced to R. Kelly while working as an intern at Epic Records during the summer of 1999, starting when she was 16 years old.
And he's like, well, can I kiss you? And I was like, no. He's like, okay, well, give me a hug. And then, like, when I gave him a hug, he just started kissing me.
Sampson tells Dateline's Andrea Canning her relationship with Kelly lasted until she was 18. It was then that she broke things off and filed a lawsuit against the singer, accusing him of sexual abuse. Kelly denied having sex with her, but settled with Sampson out of court for $250,000. Her first on-camera interview coming in the wake of anti-Kelly rallies outside of Sony Music headquarters in New York and Kelly's Chicago studio. Protesters calling for police action and an end to producing and playing R. Kelly's music. Lady Gaga, Celine Dion, and Chance the Rapper have all pulled their collaborations with the chart-topping artist.
The record companies are abandoning him. Other artists are all of a sudden acting like they're shocked by these rumors that are floating around. He's having a very difficult time, but he's strong. He's tough. He wants to put out his music and continue performing for people, and I expect that's what he'll be able to do.
Kelly's attorney says he didn't represent the artist when Sampson alleges she was abused, but insists his client has done nothing wrong to her or any of the women who have come forward.
So is R. Kelly saying that all these women, they are all lying?
That is absolutely
correct. Every one of them.
Every one of them. Yes.
Miguel, at this point, is there an official police investigation?
Well, Craig, police haven't officially or formally discussed opening one, but just last week, Chicago police visited Kelly's home after a tip that two women were being held there against their will. Police say those were independently interviewed, both women, and they say that they were being held there not against their will, and they were in good health and spirits, guys.
All right, Miguel Almaguer. Miguel, thank you. And for more of this story, you can watch Accused, the R. Kelly story. That's tonight on Dateline NBC, 10 o'clock Eastern, 9 o'clock Central.
All right, so let's get right into the show. I'm not going to comment much on what I just played because I have a lot of material to go through, and there's a lot to talk about. So if you haven't seen the documentary, the three-night series, I would encourage you. You can go online and find it, and you can watch it. But I'm going to do my best to recap as much of the series as possible so you don't necessarily have to watch it. As I said, we want to deal with his success first of all right? His success. And he's done a lot. In fact, I'm reading from Wikipedia. Robert Sylvester Kelly, born January 8, 1967, is an American singer, songwriter, record producer, and former professional basketball player. A native of Chicago, Kelly began performing during the late 1980s, and debuted in 1992 with the group Public Announcement. In 1993, Kelly went solo with the album 12 Play. He is known for a collection of major hit singles, including Bump and Grind, Your Body is Calling, I Believe I Can Fly, Step in the Name of Love, Gotham City, If I Could Turn Back the Hands of Time, Ignition Remix, The World's Greatest, I'm a Flirt Remix, and the hip opera Trapped in the Closet. In 1998, Kelly won 3 Grammy Awards for I Believe I Can Fly. His distinctive sound and style has influenced numerous hip-hop and contemporary R&B artists. Kelly became the first musician to play professional basketball when he was signed in 1997. Kelly has written, produced, and remixed songs and albums for many artists, including Aaliyah's 1994 debut album, Age Ain't Nothing But a Number. In 1996, he was nominated for a Grammy for writing Michael Jackson's song, You're Not Alone. In 2002 and 2004, Kelly released collaboration albums with rapper Jay-Z and has been a guest vocalist for other hip-hop artists like Nas, Sean Combs, and the Notorious B.I.G. Since the 90s, Kelly has been the subject of numerous allegations of sexual abuse and misconduct, often with underage women, all charges he denied. In 2002, he was indicted on 21 counts of child pornography, but was acquitted of all charges in 2008. R. Kelly is one of the best-selling music artists in the United States, with over 30 million albums sold. Kelly has released 12 solo studio albums and sold over 76 million albums and singles worldwide, making him the most successful R&B male artist of the 90s and one of the best-selling music artists of all time. He is credited for helping redefine R&B and hip-hop, earning the nickname King of Rap and King of Pop and Soul. He is listed by Billboard as the most successful R&B hip-hop artist of the years 1985 and 2010, and the most successful R&B artist in history. He has won awards including BET, Soul Train, Billboard, NAACP, and American Music Awards. So that's a lot of success he has had. He has done and accomplished lots. But does that mean we should condone his lifestyle and should still support him? I'm hoping by the time I am done going through this series, if you are supporting this guy, you will stop buying his records and really pray for his salvation. And really, as a Christian, you shouldn't even want to listen to anything that he produces anyway. But let's get right into our subject, because we have a lot to talk about. So first of all, as I said, we've dealt with his success. Now let's look at his secrets. All right. Now, the word secret means not known or seen or not meant to be known or seen by others. Synonyms for that would be confidential, strictly confidential, top secret, classified, restricted, unrevealed, undisclosed, unpublished, untold, unknown, uncommunicated, behind someone's back, under wraps, unnoticed, off the record, not for publication, circulation, not to be made public, not to be disclosed, etc. And of course, the things that I'm sharing, people have known about these secrets of R. Kelly for years, and nobody has said anything. But we're gonna talk about it. All right. So, first of all, R. Kelly and his brothers were molested as children. Okay, R. Kelly and his brothers were molested by their older sister Teresa. Okay, at the time, Teresa was, I believe, age 15. Kelly has publicly said he was molested by an older female relative as a child, first in his 2012 solo caster autobiography and several additional times over the years in Surviving R. Kelly. The singer's younger brother, Kerry, says he experienced similar abuse. If he's saying he was abused, I don't think he's lying, Kerry Kelly says in an interview for the documentary, because it happened to me. It happened to me. I was molested by a family member and it shook my world because I didn't understand it. I knew it wasn't right, even though I was 6 years old at the time. She was 15, I believe, when that occurred. So I don't know how old Robert was when he was molested. Kelly recounted going to his older brother, Robert, aka R. Kelly, about the abuse. Robert, him being my older brother, I bought that to him and told him what had happened to me. When I told him, he didn't really respond to it like I felt he should. He said, no, that didn't happen. And I said, yes, it did. And Robert said, no, it didn't. And I left it alone. I really didn't want to take it to my mom because my brother was a test. And if he believed me, maybe I could have taken it to an adult. Okay, so here you have a situation. All the three of them were molested. Nobody said anything. And of course, when you keep secrets, it gets worse. Brittany Daniels says, she commented on Twitter, it is a reminder that we need to do a better job protecting black boys. Too many of them have been abused and are walking around with trauma because they are silent about it. And of course, you have a lot of this secrecy, a lot of this ungodly behavior going on. But the Bible says the sins of the fathers are passed down to the third and fourth generation. So because nobody said anything when R. Kelly was molested and when Carrie was molested and maybe Bruce, his other brother, I don't know. Nobody said anything. Nobody did anything. So now we have the monster R. Kelly that we see today. Now we see the results of it. But let's see, what does the Bible say about keeping secrets? Luke 8:17 says, for nothing is secret that shall not be made manifest, neither anything hid that shall not be known and come abroad. Luke 12:3, therefore whatsoever ye have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light, and that which ye have spoken in the air and closet shall be proclaimed upon the housetop. Mark 4:22, for there is nothing hid which shall not be manifested. Same thing. Ecclesiastes 12:14, for God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. You need to know that the Bible says the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the good and the evil. It says in Hebrews 4:12, the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul, spirit, bone, and marrow and joints, and is a discerner of the intents and the thoughts of the heart. Verse 13 says, and there is no creature that is not manifested in his sight, the word is Jesus, but all things are naked and bare before the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Again, the Bible says God will bring every work into judgment and every secret thing. In fact, the Bible says, can any man hide himself in secret places that I see him not, saith the Lord? For do not I fill heaven and earth, says the Lord. We need to understand that you cannot keep secrets from God, and you should not keep secrets from others, because the results can be catastrophic and can destroy lots of lives. Psalms 42:21 says, shall not God search thee out, or this out? For he knoweth the secrets of the heart. All right. Romans 2:16. And the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ, according to my gospel. So even if R. Kelly has all of these secrets, God will judge him. Now, we as Christians, we have a responsibility because the Bible says that we ought to, I believe in Ephesians 5:11 says, we should have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather we should reprove them, or we should expose them. We should bring them to the light. This is why we are called the children of light. So my friend, if you are listening to this broadcast and you know anything about R. Kelly that can cause him to be convicted, you need to tell the police and tell others in authority so that he can go to jail. But we'll get into that further, because there are many Christians who believe that if someone has sinned, that we should forgive them, and that's it. But oh my friend, Christ forgives you, but there are still consequences for sin. But we will deal with that. Now, also, You Are Not Alone was inspired by one of R. Kelly's teenage victims having a miscarriage. Now, you know the song You Are Not Alone by Michael Jackson? I used to like singing that. He met Lizette Martinez at a Florida mall at age 17. I didn't know how to say no, she tearfully reflected. I found out I was pregnant, and a few days later, I miscarried. When he wrote it, he was thinking of me. Despite it being one of Michael Jackson's biggest hits, the pop legend was never aware of the song's origin. So again, here's a secret again, okay? Michael Jackson never knew. I'm sure if Michael knew that this song was written because of R. Kelly's conduct and how he treated this woman, he probably may not have used the song. But again, Michael had his skeletons in the closet as well. So, you know, that's another story. Now, Lizette Martinez says Kelly coerced her into a sexual relationship when she was underage. She said in the documentary that she became pregnant with Kelly's child when she was a senior in high school and miscarried shortly after she found out about the pregnancy. Martinez claims Kelly told her that she was the inspiration for You Are Not Alone, which became a hit song by Michael Jackson in 1995. He just said he had something really special he had been working on, she said. When he wrote it, he was thinking of me, so when he played it, he called the song You Are Not Alone. Of course, he knew that he was treating her bad and isolating these girls and, I mean, you know, all the secrets he kept. After taking the virginity of the then 17-year-old aspiring singer Lizette Martinez, he inflicted her with mono, which left her paralyzed and in the ICU for 2 weeks. Martinez tearfully shared that Kelly paid her mother $1,000 as hush money. She also said that the bout of illness came after a miscarriage that he prompted. Though their relationship ended in 1999, over the years, Kelly would painstakingly coerce her into sexual acts against her will. She ultimately decided not to take legal action against him for the sake of her own safety and mental wellness. So, of course, here's another secret was kept. But again, you know, she tried hard. And as I said, Ephesians 5:11 says, "And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret." So we have a responsibility to expose evil. And in fact, God says, if your brother offends you, go tell him his fault. If he will not hear you, then take it to the church. You should always expose sin, especially if it's a public. If it's done in public, it should be exposed. But let's move on. So there you have the secrets of R. Kelly. But now let's move on to his sadism. His sadism. Now, the word sadism is the tendency to derive pleasure, especially sexual gratification, from inflicting pain, suffering, or humiliation on others. Beneath the apparent loving concern, she had glimpses of spite and sadism. Now, synonyms for that would be barbarity, brutality, bestiality, perversion, viciousness, brutality, cruelty, savagery, cold-heartedness, bloodthirstiness, inhumanity, ruthlessness, heartlessness, maliciousness, pitilessness. All right, and you see this in Romans 1, where God says men will become unmerciful and ruthless. And this is what you're seeing, and the Bible even tells us in 2 Timothy 3 that in the last days men will become lovers of their own selves. They will be without natural affection. There will be no type of natural affection for relatives or family members or just people that we should have concern for. Now, again, R. Kelly was a sexual predator, deviant. I mean, he still is. This guy is wicked. And, you know, the Bible says, whoever looks upon a woman to lust after her in his heart has already committed adultery with her in his heart. This is why David says, "Turn away my eyes from beholding vanity, and quicken thou me in thy way." Job says, "I have made a covenant with my eyes. Why then should I think upon a maid?" We as God's people have a responsibility not to even indulge in pornography or those type of sins, because they only escalate and get worse. And I'm sure R. Kelly did a lot of that stuff and still is. But my friend, this guy, listen to this. Isolation happened intentionally among staff and with his underage victims. There was a rule being on tour with him. "The dancers do not communicate with my background singers. My band didn't communicate with my dancers. He really ran it like a dictatorship," Andrea Kelly reflected, prior to them being married. Okay, so this guy was, as a controlling person, he coerced people into doing things, underage girls, a predator. This guy is sick. R. Kelly kept several bedrooms in his music studio, which he used to entrap and sexually assault and abuse young girls in between song takes. So this guy is so wicked that while he's producing his music, and many of you listening to my show understand how I feel about listening to ungodly music, okay? Because these songs are inspired by the devil, and he's telling you, I mean, these girls have borne witness. They're telling you, listen, that R. Kelly, as he was producing his songs like Step in the Name of Love and I Believe I Can Fly and all of that stuff, he was actually committing sexual acts with women. Sometimes people be smoking drugs and cursing and other things in the studio. And I know because I've done 3 records and, you know, my Sean and I have recorded 3 albums. And sometimes we'd be in the studio and or even before we go in the studio, we would be outside the studio and we'd see guys smoking pot and all kind of other things. And that's what they do to get to prepare themselves for music. And so, of course, when we go in there, we would just have to, you know, have a time of prayer and anoint the place and do whatever and ask God to, you know, to have his way. But again, my friends, a lot of people indulge in all types of things to motivate them. Now, as several of his former teenage victims recall, including Tyrande Pace and Lisa Van Allen, Kelly would even force them to perform sexual acts on one another in these rooms as he filmed them. Enforcing his master manipulation tactics, he'd verbally strong-arm the women into such acts with pep talks where he'd tell them, if you love me, you do these things. So this guy is wicked, he's ungodly. Former backup singer Javante Cunningham claims R. Kelly had sex with an underage girl while others watched. My friends, I hate to even read this, but again, you need to know what's going on, all right? So listen to this. Cunningham, one of Kelly's former backup singers, is one of the few women interviewed in Surviving R. Kelly who worked with the singer while she was underage, but does not claim he sexually propositioned her. One of the many horrifying stories Cunningham tells recounts a time she was in the studio recording with Kelly when he started having sex with a girl she knew was underage, in full view of others. The first time I witnessed a sexual act in the studio was during the recording of Kelly's song, Slow Dance Remix. He had one of my teenage friends in the booth with him, bent over, and we were all right there. I will not say with whom, but I knew she was underage. Again, I apologize for reading that, my friends, but you need to know that you need to make a commitment to God to stop listening to a lot of these secular artists, because I'm sure R. Kelly is only one of many that his sins are being exposed, and I pray to God. Again, another writer even said that they saw Aaliyah, how he was molesting and messing with Aaliyah while they were making her album. Okay, so this guy is a deviant, wicked person. Now, this is nothing new. You find accounts of this same thing. In fact, I think specifically of Genesis 34. If you have a Bible, turn with me in Genesis 34. And we're going to read about Simeon and Levi. All right? Genesis 34. And Dinah, the daughter of Leah, which she bore unto Jacob, went out to see the daughters of the land. So Dinah is Jacob's daughter. He had 12 sons and 1 daughter. And of course, they were very protective of her. Verse 2 says, and when Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hevite, prince of the country, saw her, he took her and lay with her and defiled her. Sounds like R. Kelly. And his soul cleaved unto Dinah, the daughter of Jacob, and he loved her, the damsel, and spake kindly unto the damsel. So after all of this happened, he had a change of heart of repentance, and he wanted to marry her. And Shechem spake unto his father Hamor, saying, give me this damsel to wife. And Jacob heard that he had defiled Dinah, his daughter. Now his sons were with his cattle in the field, and Jacob held his peace until they were come. And Hamor, the father of Shechem, went out unto Jacob to commune with him. And the sons of Jacob came out of the field when they heard it, and the men were grieved, and they were very wroth, because he had wrought folly in Israel in lying with Jacob's daughter, which thing are not to be done. Now, I expect for these guys to be angry, just as I was angry, just as I read the article from Crystal, and she was angry, and many people who saw this was angry and upset and grieved, and it was saddened when you hear all the things that R. Kelly is doing to these women. And my friends, if you think this is horrible and bad, it gets worse. In fact, the third night is the worst. So I saved the best for last. But my friends, Genesis 34 verse 24 says, "And unto Hamor and unto Shechem, his sons, hearkened all." Okay, so what it basically happened was, after all of this happened, and Shechem had a change of heart, and he went to his father, then they went to Jacob, and they said, "Listen, we're sorry about what happened, but can we make a covenant with you guys, and, you know, your daughters can marry our daughters, because, you know, my son wants to marry your daughter, so you can marry our daughters, and we can trade livestock and cattle, and you guys can move in this country and live here if you like," and so forth. And so they said, okay. And they said, "Well, if this is going to happen, if you want to maintain peace." So Shechem was like, "Well, you know, that's good and all." It didn't seem like they wanted to be moved. So Shechem said, "Listen, guys, what can we do?" And the brothers said, "Well, okay, if you want to make peace with us, it's not right for us to do this. We can't intermarry with people outside our race, and it's against our religion." These are my ad libs and so forth. They use religion as a cloak of evil. And so they said, "Well, you need to be circumcised." Okay, so now let's go down to verse 24 and see what happens. Verse 24 says, "And unto Hamor and unto Shechem, his sons, hearkened or listened all of the men that went out of the gate of the city, and every male was circumcised, all that went out of the gate of the city." Now, the gate was where they had, like, court cases and judges, and so these men went there, and they told them what to do. "And it came to pass on the third day, when they were sore, that two of the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, took each man his sword and came upon the city and boldly slew and killed all the males. And they slew Hamor and Shechem his son with the edge of the sword and took Dinah out of Shechem's house and went out. The sons of Jacob came upon the slain and spoiled the city because they had defiled their sister. They took their sheep and their oxen and their asses and that which was in the city and that which was in the field, and all their wealth and all their little ones and their wives, took they captive and spoiled even all that was in the house." Now look at this, my friends. Because of this one sin, these guys destroyed an entire nation, and they took all of their citizens that they didn't kill, and they took them and made them slaves. All right? So because of this, and my friend, when you look at, there's three accounts of these horrible type of crimes being done in the Bible, and we're going to look at all three of them, but all three of them resulted in war and bloodshed and all this type of stuff. And I can guarantee you, if the world does not do something about R. Kelly, it's only going to result in murder and bloodshed, if none of that hasn't happened already. His marriage to Andrea Kelly was so controlled that he decided when and where and how he got married. So this guy was, again, like I said, he was such a sadistic person, and that he wanted to control every aspect. I mean, he would control when they ate, he would control when they went to the bathroom, if they could use their phone, if they can call their parents. I mean, it's just crazy. You know, as we go into this, you'll see there were some parents who haven't spoken to their children in more than 9 years. Some haven't spoken to their child in more than 2.5 years. So, my friend, this gets worse. So his marriage to Andrea Kelly was so controlled that he decided when, where, and how he got married. Okay, I could see that she wanted her people there. She wanted her parents there, said Bruce Kelly, his brother. Andrea recalls, "My wedding was a surprise wedding. I did not know I was getting married. The kind man who romanced her and enlisted her help with his reading deficiency quickly spiraled into a terrorizing stranger that almost drove her to suicide." But it reminds me again of 2 Samuel chapter 12. This guy wanted to have such control over his women, and we're going to get into Aaliyah, because I could hear some of our listeners probably thinking, well, what about Aaliyah? But we will talk about that soon. But in 2 Samuel chapter 13, we have an account of Amnon, Absalom, and Tamar. Now, Amnon was David's son. Now, if you know the story of David, David had committed adultery with Bathsheba. I would encourage you to listen to a warning from David to Israel Houghton. I would encourage you to listen to that. And I think other shows I did on David where I would get more into this story. But basically what happened is David committed adultery with Bathsheba. He was confronted by, and that happened in 2 Samuel 11. He was confronted by Nathan in chapter 12. And God said, the sword will never leave your house. Again, God forgave him, but the consequences of his sin had to be punished. So we can forgive R. Kelly for his sins, but he needs to be punished. Let's not get it twisted. Okay, and now you go to chapter 13, and this is the second sword that fell upon David. First, his son died, his youngest son, his baby died. And then in chapter 13, here you have an account where Amnon falls for his sister Tamar. He's in lust with her. I wouldn't even say he's in love with her, but he wanted her sexually. And so he goes to his cousin, Jonadab, and his cousin says, listen, why don't you... why you're the king's son. What are you sitting here whining and crying about this girl? You're the king's son. You can have whatever you want. Just go and ask your father for her hand in marriage and do whatever. And he was like, well, I don't know if my father will give her to me. So he says, well, then do this. You know, if you want her, then pretend to be sick and go talk to your father and let her come and prepare a meal for you in your bedroom. And then you can do what you want. So he basically did that. And she came over. She baked a cake and some other things. And when he was done eating, he grabbed her and raped her and defiled her. And then the Bible tells us that after he did that, that he had more hatred for her than many loved her. And because he had so ruined her life, she couldn't go and get married to anyone else. Now, again, the Bible says, when sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, the hearts of the sons of men are fully set in them to do evil. So when you don't deal with evil, it progresses. And just like I told you with Jacob's sons, and they destroyed that whole city, well, what happened when Amnon did violated Tamar and Absalom found out about it, he went and told David. David did nothing. And so because of that, Absalom plotted and had Amnon assassinated, killed him, and then he plotted to overthrow, concocted a political scheme and overthrew his father's kingdom. And so they went to war and David had to flee. So again, because of this one sexual sin and no one did anything about it, it progressed. Okay? Now let's talk about Aaliyah, because again, this guy, his sadism, I mean, it's ridiculous. R. Kelly's ex-assistant described Aaliyah as worried and scared during the alleged wedding. Kelly reportedly married Aaliyah on August 31st, 1994, using a falsified Cook County marriage certificate, later published by Vibe, that listed her age as 18. She was, in fact, just 15 at the time. Demetrius Smith, R. Kelly's former tour manager and personal assistant, who has come out previously with disturbing details about his time with the singer, shared more details about Kelly and Aaliyah's wedding day. Now, again, you can find videos online of when Aaliyah and R. Kelly were being interviewed. And again, she was asked, what about their relationship? And she was like, oh, we're just friends. And you see R. Kelly smiling with his sadistic self and just wicked, you know. And at the time, she was probably maybe 14 or 15. And again, I can't believe it that, you know, he was able to marry her and Hollywood kept quiet. Musicians, artists, other people kept quiet. The secrecy that goes on in this country is ridiculous. That's why we got to deal with his Satanism and the occult activity. And we're gonna talk about that in day 3. So you want to tune in, because the media didn't cover that. I am not proud of that day, he said. I had papers forged for them. Aaliyah was underage. We got the marriage license. We were at a hotel in Maywood, Illinois. It was just a quick little ceremony. Nothing elaborate. Aaliyah didn't have a white dress. Robert didn't have on a tux, just everyday wear. Robert said, "I do," him and Aaliyah. That was all it was. Aaliyah looked worried and scared, he continued. She was worried and scared. I wanted so much to go grab Aaliyah and talk to her. She gave me a look like she wanted me to talk to her. I knew that it had changed the course of everything. The marriage was annulled a short time later, with Kelly publicly maintaining that the wedding never happened. And this guy is such a liar. You know, such a wicked, ungodly liar. Now, this gets worse, my friends. And I took some time to go through his sadism and his sadistic just behavior, because this is horrific. Now, Sparkle introduced her niece to Robert, and she is the girl from that tape, all right, from the sex tape. Now, this is night two, but, you know, I pretty much tried to organize it in such a way to deal with my points. And we'll talk about this further in the next episode. But in spite of seeing firsthand how R. Kelly treated his wife, Andrea, she still, Sparkle still introduced her niece to him at age 12. 2 years later, that child, who was placed in his care for professional purposes, found herself engulfed in one of the most horrendous acts of this generation. According to Kelly's brothers, young girls were his preference. He recruited teenagers as young as 14 with the help of his entourage. So again, he couldn't read or write, so he would get other people, and Demetrius admitted that he would help him find girls as well. And I'm telling you, when we deal with his servants, it's going to shock you. The underage girl in R. Kelly's tape was allegedly the niece of one of his associates, and he lied about her age during the threesome. The second part of Surviving R. Kelly focused on the infamous sex tape that showed Kelly allegedly urinating on an underage girl. Two of the women interviewed in the documentary claim to know the underage girl in the tape. The first was Stephanie Sparkle Edwards, a singer who worked with Kelly as his bandmate and mentee, who claimed that the girl was her niece and she introduced her to Kelly when the girl was 12. "It blanked me up. It really did," she cursed. "It's over with, but it still hurts me. I should have never introduced her to him," she says in an interview, crying. "I should have never introduced my family to him. How dare he? On the tape, my niece has the same hairstyle she had when she turned 14. That was her for sure," she said about her niece's presence in the video, "and that was him, definitely." And again, like I said, there's two other witnesses to this crime. But my friends, we have something like that took place like this in the Bible. I believe this is probably the most horrible crime that the Bible illustrates in Scripture, and what happened and what occurred. The only thing that would be worse than this is the death of our Lord. Okay? But look at this. Judges 19. Now here you have a story of a Levite. And the Bible says this very carefully four times in the book of Judges. It says, "In those days there were no kings or judges in the earth, and every man did that which was right in his own eyes." And again, as I said, when sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, the hearts of the sons of men are fully set in them to do evil. And if the Supreme Court, the other courts of the land, do not convict Kelly of his sexual deviant crimes, other things will progress and it will get worse. Look at what happens here, my friend. We're going to go into this. I'll try to go through this. So here you have a Levite, all right, a Levite, and he marries this concubine, a slave woman, and after they're married for a while, she cheats on him, and after she cheats on him, she goes back to her father's house, goes back home. So he decides, he loves his wife, like Hosea, he decides he's going to go and get her back. So he goes to the father's house. And, you know, he meets the father. The father actually likes him, and he wants to speak nice to this woman and get her to come back home. He convinces her. But the father, you know, they start talking and end up drinking and partying. And this goes on for 5 days, because every time he tries to leave, the father says, man, you know what? It's getting late. Why don't you just hang around a little longer? And so it gets too late, and he decides not to leave. This goes on for 5 days. After 5 days, he says, you know what? I have to leave. And he leaves now, and his goal is now to go back home. Now, as he's going back home, he has to go through a town called Jebus, which eventually becomes Jebus Gilead and eventually becomes a part of Jerusalem. So he goes to Gibeah, and he gets there, and he's going through the city, and it's late at night, and nobody would let him come into their home. And he figures, let me go see if I could find the house of the Lord. Couldn't find it. And so this old man meets him, and the old man asks him where he's coming from, and he tells him, and the old man says, well, you know what? Don't worry about it. I have enough food and shelter and everything. You can bring your animals and your servants and your wife, and you guys can come and hang out with me, and eventually, maybe tomorrow morning, you can leave. So he goes to the man's house. They ate, they drink, and everything else. Let me read, and then now we're going to look at verse 22 and see what happens. Now, as they were making their hearts merry, behold, the men of the city, certain sons of Belial, beset or surrounded the house round about and beat down the door and spake to the master of the house. So they knocked on the door. And this is kind of like what happened in Genesis 19 with Sodom and Gomorrah. And the old men, and they say, bring forth the man that came in into the house that we may know him. These guys were sodomites. These were homosexuals. And the men, the master of the house, went out unto them and said unto them, no, my brothers, no, I pray you, do not so wickedly this thing, seeing that this man is come into my house, and he's a guest. Do not this foolish thing. Behold, here's my daughter, a maiden, and his concubine. Them I will bring out now, and humble ye them, and do unto them what seems good unto you. But unto this man do not so vile a thing. Now you say, man, these are wicked. Why would you want to put your daughter and another woman out here in this wicked situation? Again, same thing happening with R. Kelly. A lot of people know about these girls being molested, mistreated, and they just leave them there. Well, let's look at what happens. But the men would not hearken or listen to them, or listen to him. So the man took his concubine and brought her forth unto them, and they knew her and abused her all the night until the morning. And when the day began to spring, they let her go. So the entire, all the men of that city, and if you study this story, there were about 600 men in that city. So all those men abused, raped, molested her, gang raped her, whatever they wanted to do, the entire night destroyed her. And verse 26 says, then came the woman in the dawning of the day and fell down at the door of the man's house where her Lord was till it was light. Verse 27, and her Lord rose up in the morning and opened the doors of the house and went out to go into his way. And behold, the woman, his concubine, was fallen down at the door of the house, and her hands were upon the threshold of the door. And he said unto her, up, and let us go, let us be going. But she did not answer. Then the man took her up upon his donkey, and the man rose up and got him and went to his place. And when he was come into his house, he took a knife and laid hold on his concubine and divided her together with her bones into 12 pieces and sent her unto all the coast of Israel. And it was so that all that saw it said, there was not such a thing done nor seen for the day that the children of Israel came up out of the land of Egypt unto this day. Consider it and take advice and speak your mind. Okay? So he said, listen, you've seen what just happened, how this woman was gang raped and destroyed, and now the man has cut up her body and sent the 12 pieces of her body all throughout Israel so you could see all the blood and the gore and see how badly she was mutilated, because no one would believe me if I tell you, just like many of you who saw these crimes with the three-night documentary will still support this ungodly, wicked, satanic, deviant person and will not expose him. My friends, we're going to go through this. Now, what ended up happening in this is, you know what, I won't read the rest of the story because I would have to read the three chapters. So what ended up happening was the people went throughout Israel and eventually they found out that the tribe of Benjamin was at fault and the tribe of, and Gilead, the men from Jabesh Gilead, were responsible. Okay? Now these, they had 600 men who were valiant, and they could throw stones, and they could throw, you know, slingshots. They were good with slingshots, and they could, you know, they were left-handed. And also Benjamin had like 25,000 warriors as well. Now the men of Israel had over 400,000 men, and they went to the tribe of Benjamin, and they said, listen, can you guys turn these men loose? Can you, you know, just give them up? And of course, they wouldn't give them up. So they said, well, then we need to fight them. So they went out to fight them. First day, 27,000 men were killed, or something like that, maybe 25,000. Then they went and prayed to God. They said, Lord, what should we do? Should we pursue these guys? Because this is an evil crime that has taken place and nothing has happened. And so God says, yes, go and fight them. The next day, 18,000 were killed. Then they went back. They were weeping. They were wailing. They were crying. They were fasting and everything. And they were like, Lord, you got to help us out. The Lord said, okay, go back. Tomorrow I will give you victory. So, of course, they went back the next day. And the Lord gave them wisdom. And the Lord said, listen, well, the Bible doesn't tell us that the Lord told them this, but I would assume the Lord told them this because they had wisdom on what to do. And they pretended that they were going out to fight, and they sent out 30 men, and they were being pursued. And while the people were chasing them, the others came and began to burn the city down and other things. And so the people came back, and of course, God caused some sort of something to happen, and some of the men were killed, and then the rest of the children of Israel pursued the other 20,000, and they killed them, and there were about 600 left. They pursued those guys. Eventually, they killed them. So in total, about 60,000 people died because of this one horrible event that took place. Now, what ended up happening was they killed all the women and children in that city, all of those that were married, they killed all of them. And there were about 400 women that survived. You can read this account in Judges 19, 20, and 21. It's the end of the book of Judges. And so what they did was they got some of the, because the tribe of Benjamin was going to be extinct. It was going to be destroyed because they destroyed pretty much the entire tribe. So they said, we got to do something to keep Benjamin as a tribe. So they got 400 men from Israel, and they basically had this party, and they got women to come out. And when the women came out, the men grabbed the whatever women they wanted, and they took those women and made them their wives. And that's how Benjamin, the tribe of Benjamin, survived today. But this one act could have destroyed a whole tribe. And my friends, if we don't do something about R. Kelly, all he's doing is destroying our black women. Okay, so we, as God's people, we need to, again, be more conscious and more aware of the type of music and people we're supporting. But of course, we learned about Stephanie Sparkle Edwards, and she spoke about her niece. And in tomorrow's show, I'll reveal who her niece is. You're going to be shocked as we uncover this story. But the second woman to identify the underage girl in the tape was Lisa Van Allen, who says she was a victim of Kelly's abusive behavior. Kelly coerced her into having sex with him and the girl who allegedly appeared in the tape lying to Van Allen and telling her that the other girl was 16 and 14, and not 14. Okay? And I still, even if she was 16, that's still ungodly. Plus, it's a girl. And plus, they were not married. So there's many sins that Lisa Van Allen violated. But again, the Bible says the woman was deceived, not the man. But of course, I'm sure Van Allen ran into this with her eyes open. When I figured out that I had sex with a 14-year-old girl, it made me feel betrayed because he lied to me and told me she was 16, which would have been close to my age, she continued. And it also made me question his motives. I mean, the fact that he lied to me about her age told me he obviously knew that wasn't okay for her to be younger. It made me feel sick to my stomach. My daughter is older than she is now. We didn't have sex with the girl in the video anymore after I found out she was that much younger. Again, I'm glad that she had some remorse and some brokenness over that fact, but she should also be broken that she violated God's commands by fornicating and also committing homosexual acts and pedophilia all at the same time. And so, I mean, just on adultery, because Kelly was married. Of course, Kelly did all those things. But what can we learn from this, my friend? Number one, we should never, never appreciate someone just because of their success. All right? Believe it or not, Satan was successful. When he was Lucifer, he was a successful leader because he was able to convince one-third of God's angels to sin against God, the most wisest being in the universe, and follow him to hell and everything else he's doing. So he had some success. Of course, the Bible tells us, what will a man gain? What will a man profit? What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and yet loses his own soul? And anytime you study people who are successful in the Bible and don't have God in their lives, they all end up in hell and they have ruined lives. From the rich man in Luke 16 who went to hell, to the rich fool in Luke 12 who said, I will store up my goods, to Judas Iscariot, to many others in the Bible, success only destroyed their lives. So we should not judge someone by their success, but by their character. Anyone can be successful, but not every person can be godly and have integrity. And unfortunately, we in the black community especially, we like to support people because they're black. But again, Martin Luther said we should not judge someone by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. Now, of course, he was referring to the fact that many black people are treated unfairly because of the color of their skin, but we as blacks do the reverse. We support ungodly black people because they're black. But my friends, we should not do that. People should be held accountable if they're living ungodly lives, all right? And we should expose them. And then number two, what else can we learn is we should not be sadistic and not support people that are sadistic either. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 5, but fornication and uncleanness, not once be named among you as becometh saints, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, nor joking, coarse joking, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks, for this ye know that no whoremonger, nor fornicator, nor unclean person, a whoremonger is a player, okay, nor unclean person who is an idolater, had any inheritance in the kingdom of God and of Christ. And if you know that these people are ungodly, you should not want to support their music and help them to continue to perpetuate their kind of lifestyle. All right, so we should not support people that are ungodly. And lastly, of course, we should avoid secrets. You know, we should avoid secretive type of situations. We should again expose people in wrongdoing. Again, the Bible says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. We as God's people are the children of light. We are the children of the day. And we should be doing things that are visible, that people can see. We should be above board. It should be ethical, and we should be people of integrity. So again, I hope and pray that this information is helpful, that it encourages you and blesses you, and you continue to listen. Again, thank you and have a blessed day.
For more music in the news and the Bible topics, visit doubleedgemusic.com. Or if you have ideas for other topics, please email us at info@doubleedgemusic.com.